Hello everyone! Today we'll take a look at adding functionality to our keybinding UI. If you haven't seen the first part of this mini-series, you can find a link to that part in the video description. Before we start, let's talk about what we need to implement. First up, we need our UI to show a pop-up message when one of the UI buttons for input actions was pressed. Then, the next key press while the pop-up is active has to be saved and override the previous key setting for that action. After that, only the newly assigned key should work for the input action in-game. Lastly, we want the settings to be saved persistently into a file and loaded at the start of the game. These are the features we want to implement. So how do we do that? First, we start with showing the pop-up, as this is the easiest to do. I already mentioned it in the last video, but it is very important to connect each action button in our UI with the following function in options menu GD. On action button pressed. We do that at the time of creating the action button for the UI. In my case, it's line 132. We call the connect method on the action button to link the pressed event of the button with the function on action button pressed. The second argument self tells the connect method where to find the function on action button pressed. As the connect call and the passed function are both inside the optionsmenu.gd file, we just need to pass self. Also, we pass the name of a button as an argument to the function. It is the last argument and needs to be inside brackets. As the connect method can't know how many arguments on action button pressed expects, all of those arguments are passed inside an array. The logical next step for us is to look at the implementation of on action button pressed in line 154. In order to show the pop-up, all we need to do is call pop-up pop-up-centered, which will display the pop-up at the center of the game screen. There are other methods with similar functionality available as well. The reason this is so simple is because the pop-up is already integrated in our UI as a cnode via the editor. Pop-ups are just hidden until one of the according methods is called. IsInInputOverride mode defines whether the pop-up is visible and the game is waiting for the player to press a key. It's defined as false on the top of a file and set here to true. OverrideInAction is also defined at the top and has the according string for the action to be overridden. This is what happens on the press of one of the UI buttons. The next relevant function for us is input. It is called whenever a key has been pressed. First, we define a few variables. Valid input shows whether the event in input is valid for overriding our input event key in the input map. Label node is the node that we update once the reassignment is performed. And label text is the translated text displayed by the label node. Once we've checked that we are indeed in the mode of reassigning a new key, meaning is in input override mode is true, we can perform the actual overriding logic. First, we check if the input is valid. This is the case if the event argument of input is indeed an input event key. If yes, we set valid input to true. The write node can be assigned to label node by looking into the path of input keyboard. Remember that the script is attached to the root node of the scene when creating the correct path string. The actual node name will be returned by getActionKeyboardLabelName when passing overriding action. This is just a little helper function inside options menu GD. All it does is attach the string keyboard to the string of a passed action. TranslateInputLabel is also a function inside options menu.gd. For a detailed description, see part 1 of the series. In line 171, we basically get the according translation for our button from the useTranslation file. Now what we need to do is to override the input behavior of Gudu's input map. For that, we iterate through all input events of the according action in input map by using for old event in input map.getActionList with the parameter overriding action. If the old event is an input event key, we erase the event via input map.actionErase event from input map and break the for loop as we found what we searched for. After that, we add our new input event key by calling input map.actionAddEvent overriding action event. As a last step, if we've indeed overridden the key binding, we hide the pop-up again and set this input as handled by calling getTree.setInput as handled. Otherwise, other nodes in the game might react to the event as well, which we don't want. We set the actual text of the label node to label text. We set is in input override mode to false, and overriding action to an empty string. Via the file management script, we save the new configuration and directly reload it. The reloading isn't necessary, but you might want to use it to check whether the settings were saved correctly in the file. If they weren't, you can then react to it directly and let the player know. Those two lines naturally lead us to the next block of code, this time inside filemanagement.gd. First, let's take a look at the loadConfig function. We create a new config file data structure in order to load the contents of settings.cfg into it. The user path used here is the default path for where apps are allowed to store data by the OS. On Windows, this is for example the app data, roaming, Godot, app user data, plus the project name, directory. So this is where you need to put the settings.cfg file in. After loading it, we need to check whether the file was loaded correctly, and if that is the case, we can read the contents of the file. If not, then we create a default valid config file. By doing so, we override a potential invalid file and autocorrect the settings for future runs of the game. A config file in Godot has different sections, and each section can have multiple keys with different values. So in our case, the section we are looking for is input. We could use any other name, of course, if we so desire. Then we iterate through all keys in the input section of the file. For simplicity, I decided that a key in the input section of a config file corresponds to an action in our input map. That way, we can easily change our input map by calling input map.actionErase events with the argument key. This deletes all input bindings for the action, that being key bindings, gamepad bindings, mouse bindings, etc. After that, we iterate through the value of our currently selected key element in the config file. This value is an array of all the bindings that we want to have for an action. As there is no way to attach all values of the array directly to our input map action, we iterate through all values and add each of them to the action in input map via input map.action add event with the arguments key and event. So as you can see here, in order for this to work, it is very important that settings.cfg contains an input section with a key for each action. The key needs to have as its corresponding value element an array containing all input events that we want to bind to the action. This includes input event keys, but also mouse and joystick events if you want to support those. Now let's take a look at saveconfig. This function is quite simple. Again, we create a variable of the config file data structure. Then we iterate through all actions of our currently used input map with for action in input map.getActions. Then we add a new key value to the, at this point not yet existing, file by calling config.setValue input action and input map.getActionList action. The arguments in line 33 are as follows. The first two arguments are the section and the key for the new value. The third argument is the actual value to be saved. We save all events as an array by calling input map.getActionList with the argument action. After that, we save our new config as a file on disk in the same save path as we load from. Notice that we don't need to worry about file syntax or creating sections for the file. All of that is done automatically by the according functions used. This helps a lot with reducing the code and helps to avoid bugs. The last two functions aren't needed for this tutorial, but are instead part of a project I'm developing. So after all this, all that's left to do is to call loadconfig once at the start of the application, and we're done. I hope you liked this mini-series. If you did, feel free to leave a like. If there are any questions left, feel free to ask them in the comments. Thank you very much for watching this video, and until next time, bye bye!